have right here. I'm going to have my co-hosts introduce themselves real quick.
Darone Buffington, Business Development Manager for Visiting Nurses Association.
My name is Donnie O'Megawan. I'm a public servant as well as you.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I'm positive. Yeah. Also, I like to say RIP to my uncle Charles. He passed away last night.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
And I was getting ready to say we lost Larry Cunningham of the Floaters yesterday. He passed away in Arizona. He was the one, he said, I forgot what his sign was, but he said, and my name is Larry.
Right.
I love it.
He had a deep voice.
Right.
I work with one of his relatives.
Okay. Also, Denise LaSalle, who said she was a singer, and she said, I'm trapped by this thing called love. Testify, lady, testify. But she passed away yesterday also. So we're losing people in the entertainment industry. Well, Nancy Wilson a few weeks ago already said that. And we have A.J. Williams coming. We're going to be talking about, a lot of people watched that documentary, and I know people have talked about it on various shows this week. We're going to come from several different angles on it. And also, we're going to talk about Santoya Brown, who was, she was given clemency. But it was so unfair, it seemed like.
Absolutely.
16 years old, now she's 30. So we're going to go to a break. Is that? Oh, no. So we're going to get started. And then when AJ comes in, you know, AJ is the lifestyle editor for the Chronicle. So I want to first find out, did you all get to watch the documentary?
Yes.
It's like people saw it and they were glued to it.
It was two things. It was hard not to watch, and then it was hard to watch. You know, you wanted to see how bad it got, but at the same time, while seeing how bad it was getting, people were repulsed.
Right.
It was very disheartening.
Right. I was actually embarrassed. You know, as a black man, I was embarrassed that our community continues to allow this to happen to our young women.
We're going to go to a break for a moment because we definitely want AJ in the conversation, and she's here now.
Situation. You know, no other community is broadcasting or putting their people on the spotlight. It's always in the bad light. Sure, do we have a lot of pictures of great black men doing great things? Yes, we do. But these things are, you know, they broke numbers. Lifetime did with R. Kelly.
Yes.
So, yeah, it's absolutely embarrassing that when you hear what women think of black men, you know, we don't protect them, we don't look out for them, we don't take care of them. It's absolutely sad to hear.
What was your first impression? First impression, I have several layered impressions, but first impression was very, it was heartbreaking. It was very heartbreaking. I wasn't in a position of, I couldn't even get to the layers of, you know, who being robbed or this or XYZ. It was overall the series is very sad to see people or young women go through a perspective of life like that or experience those traumas. What's so interesting, though, our county is not an uncommon story.
It's not.
And that's really what my perspective was. Like, that, and a lot of people may or may not agree with me. I'm a very big picture person. I'm not just going to look at this one segment. Like, the cycle of abuse. There was a lot of comments on Facebook, and a friend of mine put a comment that I thought was very, very true. And it was like, while we're condemning R. Kelly, yes, predator, monster, whatever you want to call him, we need to start addressing the hurt that happens with your uncles, with your brothers. Like, this is something that happens that we shun, and I'm not, and I will go a step further and say not just with young women. I know tons of stories with young men that have been molested.
Yes.
As a child. Like, this back is something we need to address on a deeper level.
And R. Kelly's brother, as well as R. Kelly, both admittedly were
molested. Right, it's a cycle of abuse.
Yeah,
right.
But, you know, some people are using that as an excuse. And I don't know. They were. And I had some problems with that because when he said, when somebody said, well, he was molested, I said, oh, hell, who wasn't? But, no, I don't mean it like that. But there were so many people who were, who did not go after young.
And just to go back to kind of what Darnell said, it was upsetting as a black man watching, because actually I looked at it like we failed on so many fronts. When you sit there and you look at it, we failed in regards to him as a man, being a predator to these young girls, not having self-control. We failed when you look at the lives of these, I call them children and young ladies. A lot of them didn't have fathers in their lives. So nobody was there to protect them.
But some did, yeah.
A couple of them, but the majority did not. And I think he took advantage of that because it seemed to me that he looked for certain types of young girls. He looked for the ones that were vulnerable, not just vulnerable, but extra vulnerable. Do you have a good relationship with your family? Do you have a strong family background? Things of that sort. And then when you look at all of the men that were around him and nobody said, stop. Like, stop.
I agree with that. There was a part for me, because I watched a little bit of it here last night. I haven't taken it doses. But there was a part for me where I believe his road manager or his tour manager was saying, when he was filming the part where we were getting to the 14-year-old young lady, and he was filming, and he came to him, and he said, I got a problem. I can't stop doing this. I can't stop filming. Like, this is something. There, if you, and I'm a pseudo-psychology buff, please, not real. But I watch a lot of, like, and I read a lot about it. And the thing with predators, a lot of times, and they talked about, they may be, like, hidden in plain sight a lot of times. And I heard it, and I'm not getting this. Please understand. Please don't drive me off Facebook. Like, I understand the underlying perspective of, I heard a call for help. He came to his people several times. So, what my thing is, if we're going to judge R. Kelly as we should, we need to judge his people around him.
Absolutely.
We also need to judge the parents of the girls.
Absolutely.
Because let me tell you, I'm not a parent. I have nieces and nephews. Unless somebody comes tell me that they've been touched, we're not taking a payout. We're not taking anything. We want to say, I'm sure the wrong agree with me with your doctor. We're not taking anything.
We have daughters, and that's why I wanted you on here, because I know how much you love your beautiful daughter, and your beautiful daughter.
She wanted to be here with you.
I have two daughters, and one of my daughters, my oldest daughter, she used to be pretty heavy set, and but older men tried to talk to her as a young girl. Because they thought she was older, or whatever. She said, Mom, I knew not to talk to her.
But what happened when those men found out how old she was? See, now, being a former high school teacher, I can remember when I came into the high school, I looked very young. I was maybe 25, and my principal, Dr. McLean, at that time told me, do not let these young girls get you in trouble. Control yourself. he didn't have to tell me, but he went the point to let me know that I was going to have problems in there. And I did, but at that point, you have to realize that these are kids. You know, no matter what they look like, how they're shaped, how well-developed they are, once they talk, you knew that they were children.
Absolutely. My biggest problem is, of course, R. Kelly. My biggest problem is with all the adults around him who witnessed it and saw everything.
But when you look at that, I don't look at them. Some of them being able to hold him accountable just for the simple fact they were on his payroll.
You know, I get it, but
he was controlling them to a certain extent as well.
Exactly.
When his brother went to trial, and you know he did that interview, and his brother wouldn't cop a plea for him. You know, he fired his brother.
Right.
And you know, when he went on to the interview, and he was asking him, you know, well, your brother this and this and that, he's an employee. No, he's not an employee of mine. Well, should we listen to him? No, you shouldn't listen to him because I fired him. And, you know, it was still that same kind of control there. And even with his assistant that he was talking to.
Well, we're going to take a quick call. Just a real quick call because we have a lot to discuss. Good morning.
Good morning, Glenn.
Hi.
Good morning to your staff.
Good morning.
I just wanted to chime in on R. Kelly. You know, the bottom line, all of us are victims to some degree or another. And all of us have some accountability. And so when we talk about R. Kelly, R. Kelly is not the only one. They're great. Many of our people are before us, and we are the first to crucify our own people, which is really sad. You don't see other nationalities do what we do. We are the
but they do it.
Our own, the way we do. And you know, R. Kelly drives our history just here in this country. It's just, you know, you want to talk about people that like to say, well, what's really behind all of this, really? You know, he's got a lot of music out there. Someone stands to benefit from all the music that he has produced. Who's behind all of this? Do we ever take the time to look at this? We can't justify what R. Kelly done. But every last one of us have skeletons in our closet. No one knows our secret thoughts except the Creator. And we have had many thoughts, and if it was laid out on the table, many of us would be ashamed of what some of the things that we have done and what we have done or whatever.
What are you saying in relation to what we're talking about? I don't think we're judging as much as so many of us already knew what was going on.
We are on the airwaves. We are on the airwaves. So there are many people that are listening to this. And there are many people that have many thoughts about the situation with it. And many of us understand, you know, we don't deal with our own selves or whatever. You know, because within our own selves, understand, we have all fallen short. It's to some degree or whatever, you know. And so when these people that runs this world, they're one of us out there, what feels like we understand to unreliance, and we just beat it up or whatever. The same thing will happen with Michael. Michael, I understand, left here with him being slandered or being accused of child molestation. And Bill Cosby 30 years ago or whatever. And then we sit back. We just like the scriptures describes us. We are always the people that were there when they crucified our Lord. And we do the same thing
Hold on. We can't identify these men as Lord.
Jihad, listen, one of the panelists wants to talk to you, Durant.
So I understand what you're saying, but in reality, you have to hold the people that are doing wrong accountable. Wrong is wrong and right is right. The man is wrong. So
it's right what you're saying,
but hold on. If he's wrong, we should be the first ones as African Americans to step up and hold him accountable and say, man, you're wrong. For so many years, that hasn't been done. And we're wrong for that. We're wrong for that.
Absolutely.
And if we as a race want the respect that we deserve, we have to hold the people that are doing wrong in our community accountable.
But what Bill Clinton did wrong and whatnot, there was many of us that made jokes of it. We played that off. Mom and Dad was a white man in their relationship. We played that off. Go back and check the record.
But we can't
saying make it seem like you love atheism or right and wrong.
When I say this, I hear you. I totally understand. And I'm not saying that. This is where I come from a perspective. I agree with Deron in the perspective of true. We can debate back and forth between, you can bring up Kevin Spacey, you can bring up a whole bunch of people in this perspective when it comes to the movement of Me Too. But this is our own. At a point, we have to address it. We have to address it.
We know this
20
years ago.
Why all of a sudden now it's I'm so glad you bring that up, because that's what I was going to say. At a point, where there, you can say what you want to say, but where there's smoke, there's fire. And if you watch through the documentary, this has been something that's been occurring for years, that because we didn't want to put our own out there, because we didn't want to believe what was happening, we turned a blind eye.
And he's gotten worse.
And the thing is, whether it happened now or 20 years ago, it has happened. It, you know, we have to, women, well, I walk up a bit in our shoes. I taught for 39 years. I won't tell you of the harassment I had from men who wanted to have an affair or whatever, and I couldn't do it. I did not do it. But how you're chased down, you're wondering, is he going to say something to me today? The things that women go through, it's coming to light because of Me Too and all this stuff. But these are our daughters.
And that's the reason why, Jihad, you asked the question, why now, 20 years later? It's because it wasn't one incident that happened 20 years ago, which he did go to trial for, which they threw it out or dismissed it or whatever, but he had reoccurring behavior, and it's gotten worse.
It's continuing today.
That's the reason why now it's coming up.
And there's no limitations on justice. If somebody did something to my wife today, if somebody did something to my daughter or my mother, I want justice today, and if I don't get it today, I want it 20 years from now. It doesn't stop. The pain doesn't stop. The hurting doesn't stop.
But the thing is about, like I say, when you look at what I said 20, 30 years ago, our mothers understand were totally different than what they are today. My sisters didn't understand 17, 16, 18. They weren't allowed out the door. My mother knew everywhere they possibly, if they could, where they would go or whatever. They kept a dial on it because they knew something about nature. They knew something about understanding women coming into that time when they would be looking at men and men were looking at women.
Well, but at that same time, this was happening back then, too. It was just kept hush-hush.
People thought they'd lose their jobs. People, women, you got to be able to walk a mile in our shoes. Gerard, I appreciate you calling.
I appreciate you.
Okay.
Thank you.
I want to say that. Okay. Because he talked about this whole 20 years ago. There is a perspective, and being a woman, being a black woman, it touched me. If, you know, I have perspectives, I know people personally who haven't dealt with R. Kelly, but have their own personal stories of abuse or sexual abuse or emotional abuse. What I want to say is, and this is because people can go back and forth, he started the whole, his Facebook page, Facebook shut him down, trying to dispute a lot of the lies and saying that this wasn't true. I'm going to eliminate, not saying that nobody is true or not. I will eliminate the videotape because he was found not guilty.
Wait, can I say something on that?
I want to go to a very core point.
Go ahead.
I will eliminate everything because you can go, people, because that's bringing the court. Oh, this is hearsay. Oh, they trying to get him off. Proof positive. R. Kelly married Aaliyah at 15. That's proof positive. There's no debating it.
That is recorded.
It's no fact. It's in flourishing documents. Her parents got her. Now we can go back and forth. I have some issues with it being mama, but that's my own issues. But here's my thing. Proof positive. At the age of 27, this man was having sex with a 15-year-old. Now, if we had addressed it then, maybe some of this could have been. So you can't give me whether
I don't know why.
I had a student who actually brought it at homecoming. She's 1 year younger than me.
Right. I mean, what I'm saying is I had a conversation with her. Nice girl.
Mm-hmm.
Nice, nice girl. And the hurt that was felt by this young man when the marriage thing came up.
Yeah.
I mean, but you were saying something.
I wanted to go back because a lot of people are using this. Oh, he was found not guilty. So when you look back and you look at the transcripts, they said proof positive. That is R. Kelly in this video.
Yes.
The reason he was found not guilty is because they could not identify the age of the young girl in the video to say that she was an adolescent or that she was not over the age of 17.
Nobody would come forward.
She would not testify, and the father said that it was not her. But they identified and said that is him in the video doing this to this young lady. They just could not identify how old she was in there. That is how he got off. Not to say that he didn't do it, not to say that that was not the girl per se. They had a lot testified at basketball coach, someone coached on her team, but she would not admit it. Yeah, and from that point, she was 15 when it happened, or 14 when it happened, and when she went to court, she was like 21, and she still looked the same. So they could not say, well, you know, how do we know this didn't happen 2 days ago, 5 days ago, whatever, because she still looked like a young lady, a young girl. So that throws that out of the window. You know, he was not in it. That was him.
Well, let's go to the question, do black girls' lives or women's lives matter? Do you think that if these were white young girls that he would have gotten away with?
No. Black man, white man? No.
I differ in my opinion. I do believe there is an issue. It's my protect her shirt. I do think there is an issue with black women and the things that happen to us on a general perspective, from abuse to acknowledgement to work to, we're the last on the totem pole, we're ignored. I do agree with that. However, in this particular environment with R. Kelly, and one of the ladies on the document talked about it consistently, about this patriarchal, misogynistic tone that's in the music industry, that a lot of this stuff was the norm. You talk about a lot of rock, you know, stars and things like that. I think if R. Kelly was white, it would have went the same. If the girls were white, it would have went the same way.
I differ on that.
Right. And so we understand that this is, you know, culture of the entertainment industry, right? But on a deeper level, in our community, right, we are lacking, right? Raising our children. If this kid is not taught to be a man, right? And so on and so forth. So the R. Kelly video was just a larger reminder of the incident at McDonald's, right? You saw a girl fighting a man across the counter, and those young black men
stood there and watched
because they didn't know what to do, right? For whatever reason, you can say it was the upbringing, whatever, right?
She was able to take care of herself.
Exactly. And so, but that's the picture, though.
That's what we do.
Right, exactly. And so that's the picture that's being painted constantly in the black community, is that the woman has to do it all by herself. Evident at the McDonald's counter.
But I beg to differ in regards to if those girls were white, just for the simple fact, black man, white woman, white girl, it doesn't equate to freedom.
I would agree with you from a perspective. I'm sorry. I guess when I view it, I'm like, if the artist was white, if the girls were white, it would go the same way. If it's a perspective, if it's R. Kelly himself and the women were white, I would agree.
That's true.
Okay, I'm sorry. I misunderstood from that perspective. No, I would agree with you.
I really thought that white women were the most precious thing to white men on this earth until Donald Trump got into office. Like, you could not do something to a white woman, you are going to be punished.
Period. Like, if you're black.
Oh, definitely.
Because white men do stuff to white women all the time.
But the scenario would have changed 20 years ago, because if I was a 14-year-old white girl in the video, her family standing up, they would have taken
under the
payoff.
Under
right.
the
gym. So it would have been handled totally different from the giddy up.
Okay, so here's my thing, and this is always my thing. We could go back to the whole when the documentary came out about Dr. Dre, and we still wear beats. But, you know, here's the thing with social media, and it's so interesting because even outside of social media, because it happened years before with the 14 Fitzgerald and everything else with R. Kelly, with Aaliyah, at a point, we become so sensationalized that we did, after a month, nobody is going to be talking about this anymore. Yeah. So, what I love about the Me Too movement and what I love about kind of women kind of having their voice to come forward is, with this is, where do we go from here? Like, from a community perspective, not necessarily from a legal perspective.
Before we go on, Jada Pinkett asked a question. She said, why do we forgive so easily? No, not that wasn't her question. Her question was, why did the record sales go on? But somebody, a lot of people talk to me about this. Why do we in our community forgive so easily and kind of give people a pass? And she was talking initially about Bill Cosby, because what he's been doing has been going on quite a long time.
So this is what I mean by where do we go from here. And I bring you back to the very beginning of the cycle of abuse starting. Now, here's the thing when you talk about child abuse. A friend of mine that was an alcoholic, and he has a brother. He can't stand people who drink, period. Like, drug parents and things like that. His brother, however, ended up going the whole opposite way and ended up being struck out on drugs and things like that. Cycles of abuse affect people differently. And so, I'm not saying to excuse, we have to go back to the very beginning of the cycle of abuse that started with R. Kelly being exposed to sex at this young age. That trickled over into the parents being exposing their children. The one girl who mama let her go to Chicago with a grown man. Like, how do we stop the cycle of abuse and start to address these things? Because that's where you're right now. We're talking about symptomatic things. We need to fix the root. We need to acknowledge the fact that there is abuse. Like, the thing that happens in Black communities so much, this is why people are too ashamed to go to therapy. We shouldn't talk about what's going on. And things like this, we have a nature of, and it comes from slavery, and it comes from just be strong, shift your underwear, what don't break you, make you stronger. No, it broke me, and I need that to be heard. So what happens is, the reason why we forgive so easily is because people, I guarantee, people are watching the surviving archives like, oh, please, I've been through worse. My uncle, my dad, and I ain't doing this. So we forgive. We will shift under because we don't want to pull back.
We can associate ourselves with the past.
And we forgive. We remove ourselves. We remove ourselves, but the danger in that is the next person could be your daughter, my daughter. You know, that could be the next person. We have to stop. You know, and you think about it. You saw those parents who were trying to communicate with their child. For one thing, I knew where my kids were. You know, I knew where they were, and then they're like girls. Now, when I was a kid back in the day, and you know, it was shown up day, I admired David Ruff, the Temptations, whatever. If they ever talked to me, I wouldn't have known what to do. I said, wait a minute, I ain't going with them, you know.
You never know, but I'll go even further in regards to the cycle of abuse. If we go all the way back, this is. Abusing Black women has been going on for years. And when I say years,
Thomas Jefferson.
You talk about slavery.
Yeah.
You know, how women were raped and, you know, it was swept up under the rug. Nobody wanted to discuss it because they didn't want to acknowledge what was going on because there was nothing that they could do about it.
And
it's trickled down for years and years and years to where, hey, this is what happens. It's hush-hush. You know, we don't want to say anything about it. We don't want to talk about it. We don't want to embarrass the family. You know, when young girls would get pregnant due to these things, they would ship them off, things of that sort. So that's just happened over years and years and years. And I'm really glad. I'm glad Dream did the docuseries in the way that she did, because it started conversations to where we have to address what's going on.
Women have been coming out talking about it now.
Right.
And men. I've had men tell me.
The shame is taken away.
I've had men tell me how as little boys, you know,
of course.
That shocked me more than anything. In relationships that I've been in, and it's so funny because of a previous relationship I was in, he explained that his we were just having a conversation. He was like, oh, yeah, when I was 12, my uncle came and got me, and, you know, he went and he got me a prostitute. I was like, oh, this is why he was like, she was like 26. I was like, sir, this explains a lot. But this also is not right in front of her. It became such a norm type thing. And here's the thing, and I know it's different from a perspective of, I don't know, but from the male point of view or a female point of view, but what is that is when you're introduced too early to certain experiences in life, it alters your mentality. It alters your experiences and how you express that. I think that one of the, and I do love that Dream Hunt did put it from the perspective of bringing that up, because and bringing in the psychologist who said that what happens is you internalize, and I don't think people really understand, hey, what's hidden doesn't get healed. Like, seriously, it doesn't. That's why in AA, you have to first say, I am an alcoholic. So, with her, she talks about, with one of the psychologists, that he became in a place of, I'm never going to be, as a kid, unconsciously, I'm never going to be this person again. I'm never going to be in a position of servitude again where I can't protect myself. So now I'm going to be the predator. And it's sad because there are, what's so sad is there are a lot of people walking around with this mentality.
Mm-hmm.
Because we aren't entrusting the shame.
And because they come from an environment where it was happening all the time, right? It is a deviant behavior to them. So, like the guy who uncle took him to get a prostitute at 12, maybe that happened to the uncle.
Yeah.
Maybe that happened to the uncle and all his brothers.
Yeah.
So, all they were doing is repeating what's happened. And so, that's what Daron was saying, is that when you go far as back as a slaver and women being mistreated and you being a slave, and they mistreated your wife in front of you, and you couldn't do nothing because they, you know, do whatever they did to you. It's psychosis. It's
the way I tell people all the time. It's such a short read, but I mean, every black person needs to read the Willie Lynch letter.
Yes,
it talks about how this is going to affect 300 to 400 years later. When you talk about it, I'm not saying that this
not just physical. It's psychological.
It's psychological. Where a black woman is fighting, and the man is just there.
Right.
Like, because it's psychologically embedded, and unless we talk about we're broken, we have these issues, mm-hmm. we need to come together and realize that we're not
the same thing when we, you know, they talk about crimes from police against black men and women, and then people say, well, what about black on black crime? And we don't want to talk about that.
We don't want to talk about that.
We have a call. We have Thomas on the line. Good morning, Thomas.
Good morning. Happy New Year, everybody.
Happy New Year.
Thank you. The term conversation was used a couple of times. We need to have a conversation, which is fine and dandy. But if that conversation doesn't include how intimacy and sex is being demonized, particularly in this country, this country wants to control everything, including your orgasm, if I can say that from TV. But, of course, now, rape is rape. Rape is violence. It's being taken against your will. People usually are beat up and after that, killed. There's inappropriate behavior, if you can use that term. But women in the United States, I think a lot of people go through sexual intimacy dysfunction because these entities, these powers in the United States have said what's appropriate and what's not appropriate. I mean, they want you to run away from sexual intimacy. You know what I'm saying? Now, today, with this Me Too movement, you know, men and women, they don't even want to tap you on your shoulder and say, oh, hi, good morning. You know, it's gotten to a really fever pitch level where we're being programmed to literally turn they're victims of a programming of macho, I mean, this United States that demonizes intimacy and sex. And as a result, all kind of outcomes are negative and shy. So I just want to say that.
Okay, well, we're going to talk briefly about that. Well, thank you.
You know, I've long said that, you know, for example, and I don't know if you've been over to Europe, but if you go to Europe, right, watching breast on television isn't anything, right? Because it's a female body, right? And breasts are actually for feeding children, right? But we have this culture where breast is a sexual tool, right? When it's not, it's actually to feed the children, right? And so I'm saying, so part of our culture, what he's saying is part of our culture. It is. So a lot of things that you feel are based on morals and principles that somebody gave you, right? And so if an entire culture says, ooh, sex is taboo or women breasts are taboo, right? And then you hide them and you cover them up, right? Sure, children are going to want to see them. But if they see them as what they are, is a part of a woman's body, and they're there to feed the children, you wouldn't have these, I won't say you won't have it, but people will be more open. Right now, everything is covert. It's covered up, you know. It's part of it.
It's a lot covered up, but also, I was just, I kind of chuckled about that because breastfeeding, they serve that function.
Exactly.
But they also,
seen the 12-year-old with AK-47 actually killing and being killed, right? So you can, but what she says is, exactly, but everything that you do as a child is brainwashing, right?
But that's why you shouldn't be doing these certain things as a child.
No, no, I agree.
You can't make a decision.
I totally did, but
it's a middle ground. I don't think that you should be having, you know, exposed to a level of sexuality at 12 where you're having it, especially with a grown man.
No, I totally get it.
I know you're not saying that. But I also do believe that there should be, like, one thing that I didn't agree with, and I had a conversation with a friend of mine who was like, no, I don't want to listen to, like, sex music and outside of the bedroom. For me, I don't.
That ain't sex music, outside the bedroom.
You know,
going to AJ's dating life.
Was this the same guy? This is the same guy with the uncle. AJ, this is the same guy with the uncle?
No, that
was a different guy. Son up at 5 a.m. driving a tractor, begs to differ.
Right,
you understand what I'm saying?
Right,
so it's our perspective. And if we start putting it in the closet, even if we just say, I hear you, but with sexuality, that's the issue. We can have a conversation with our children about sexuality. Right? And you should. Because it becomes the preacher daughter syndrome, right? They've been held in the church like all their life, and then when they get some.
Tell me, why do you think his record sales went up?
So, this is what I think. I think a lot of people didn't know, or because they referenced, this is my thinking, not to be wrong. They referenced a lot about certain songs, made certain innuendos. So, I think a lot of people start to go back to stream and listen and try to connect the dots of, oh, this is what this is. Or
they
ain't
gonna spend
no
money on that. You know why they did it?
Or they figured he's about to go to jail. Let me get this music before they take
exactly.
it.
Exactly. The same reason why Spotify and Amazon Music was flooded the day Prince died. Because you didn't have your library in order, and the world just changed, and you didn't get those. Exactly. So that's the reason why. They saw the writing on the wall. They like, oh, let me get my R. Kelly catalog together.
I have a question, though. Really, so I would love to hear what your opinion is in regards to R. Kelly being muted, like from places like Spotify and Amazon Music, or, you know, there's this big conversation of will you ever listen to R. Kelly again? And a friend of mine was like, look, I'm not going to listen on Spotify, but I have this 12-play CD from Sam Kinney from back in the day.
Now, listen to this. If you like the Cosby Show, you'll still like the Cosby Show. You may not like what Bill Cosby did. And the same thing, I had this conversation with my daughter. She said, I still like these songs. Mom, I don't like what he did, but I like the song. Music is...
It's music.
Right, I'm not...
Because if you start muting everybody, right? Think about all the stuff that went on back in the day. Your boy, If You Think You're Lonely Now, right? Marrying somebody else's
old.
Right, so. The music.
Sound like it's bringing back memories, man.
The music is the music, and it's going to be there forever, right?
Right.
I'm more interested in. If you want to mute R. Kelly, and I guess my question would be this. Every time a song is played on Spotify, do he get a dime from it?
Yes. And I think that's where, when you talk about mute R. Kelly, it's about stopping him financially from being able to do the things that he does, stopping him from touring to make money, things of that sort. Not just the fact of listening to the music, but...
Did y'all see him 2 nights ago? Did y'all see him 2 nights ago?
On the party, the birthday party?
Oh, yeah. You see that?
R. Kelly.
So, R. Kelly, right, he calls a club and says, I'm coming to your club tonight in Chicago. V45 is the name of it. And they put out that he was coming to the club. Ticket sales went through the roof. The place was jam-packed. Everybody had their cell phone out. He was singing. Everybody was videotaping. It was girls on the video. Somebody, take me hostage. They were screaming. You can take me hostage.
True story. R. Kelly was here for he was here for Detroit, with Charlie Wilson, he was at a local cigar bar. I'm not saying that, but he was at a local cigar bar, and I went there, and on my way out, heading in, it was so there was all these trucks and everything, and this guy stops and he's like, you know, he was security for R. Kelly, and R. Kelly was in there with his entourage also, while he always went to the concert at Spider, and he was still there. He was like, you know, I think you want to come to the concert, I can get you backstage. I was like, no, sir. So I cannot come. And he was shocked. He was like, are you serious? He was like, I can get you to be R. Kelly. I was like, no. I was like, I can't publicly support R. Kelly. And he was like, oh, you wanted him? I was like, oh, yeah, yeah.
It's
not a good pickup line.
Well, it's not a line that your public person.
I'm not going to be an R. Kelly concert. I'm going to turn
on. I will say that bothers me. Because as I'm watching this, and this is part of the demented me, as I'm watching, you know, the docuseries, I kept thinking, like, we should just buy up the pit at the Fox when he comes, and a bunch of men, and, you know, reach up to give him a fight, and yank his butt down into the pit and beat the living daylights out of him. So the fact that he's at a club, and they announce it,
and the place that to me
would be a call like, oh, we're about to get him. We know where he's going to be. Let's get him now.
And they gave it numbers. It was 80% women in the club. And there was people all in there saying, oh, man, he at the V45. I ain't got no tickets. I'm so mad I'm not there. I mean, I was just watching the news feed just roll. I mean.
But you know what? I can't be shocked. Let me tell you why. Because it's so funny. One of the young ladies who became one of the survivors was at his trial.
Yes, you bet.
On his trial, it goes back to some of the conversations and some of people. Cognitive dissonance is a very real thing. And people don't want to acknowledge the fact that this is happening. You know, it could be on your own internal things. And it's very easy to dismiss, like you said, forgive. And like, oh no, they just trying to get him. Or Kelly just doing this.
He's
this. This is why I don't go into hearsay when I try to do it at debate on certain subjects. Because I go back to the very true fact of that's fine. Okay, let's just say all of them wanted money or XYZ because a lot of them got payouts. But let's go back to the fact. What is the fact that he was 27 having sex with a 15-year-old? And flourish the documents that start there. Let's go back to that conversation, and people just dismiss it because people still want to be able to be attached, and women are a very big part of that. This shows a lot about what goes on with us internally.
I had a conversation with a lady yesterday at the doctor's office. She's one of my clients, and she and I had an in-depth conversation about R. Kelly, and she was like, well, you know, I just don't. I mean, she kept making excuses and kept making. I said, well, what about if, you know, you have a daughter? How old is your daughter? She was like, my daughter is 13. I said, she's right at the age where he would
have her. I heard another lady say to me, she says, I didn't watch it because there's a president who, the president we have now says he wants to grab women by the you know what. And so they can't be condemning R. Kelly if they have a president who.
This is what I don't get. It kind of goes back to what the gentleman has said. No, she's totally right. We are jacked up in this country because our president is out here grabbing women's parts, and he's still the president. So, yeah, she is right. But we're also right in the fact that just because he did wrong and not condemn of his sin does not make this sin okay either.
Absolutely.
It's just the fact that it goes beyond. I mean, we can get into race politics all day long. But at the end of the day, the fact is wrong is wrong. I take a very higher approach from a perspective of I'm throwing a lot of people in this basket. R. Kelly, whoever that was that molested him and his brothers, the parents. Like, it's not just R. Kelly. That's my stance. I've got to think about that. It's just wrong it all up.
And it's opened the door for me to just look at the people that I idolize. Like, you know,
because I hear that R. Kelly is going to start naming some names.
No, but yeah, and not just that, man. I loved Muhammad Ali for years. And I look, he was 25 when he married a 17-year-old. You know,
and I know how to bring up Elvis Presley.
He was 30 and then an 18-year-old.
Yeah.
Same thing right there either, but, you know.
There's not.
But here's what I do. What do children. I love hearing the children when I was
growing
up. It was just one of my things that it was pop culture that I grew up on. All Bundy, right? So, and I love him now on Modern Family. But what I noticed with the two of those shows, because now Married with Children is off the move, I've been watching it, and a lot of the stuff that's on this show, I was like, oh my God, we tolerated this. We tolerated this, this subjection of women, of justification, and it's not even from, it's a little bit from a satire perspective, but this is the culture of the 90s.
Yeah.
This is where we were at, because women didn't have the wherewithal or the platform to bring to the fact that these things are happening. Me Too causes a conversation and change. Black Lives Matter causes a conversation and change. The survivor R. Kelly causes a conversation and change. Don't stop talking, because even though movement is slow, movement is still moving.
And here's one of the points I always bring up too, is why do you think the divorce rate is so high right now? Because it's easy. Right? It's easy. So let me put it in perspective, right? A woman today has one child and she's a professional. She has a problem with her husband, she can get a divorce and walk away. But a woman with 10 kids that lived at home or was a stay-at-home mom back in 1920, where was she going to go?
Are you coming from the perspective that women's rights destroy the family structure?
No, that's not what I'm saying.
Okay.
So here's what I'm saying, AJ. Here's what I'm saying. The resources to get divorced right now are there, and they're easy. Back then, a woman with 10 children who was a stay-at-home mom had nowhere to go. So what we need to do is educate our community. So when we have these issues, like you said, when the abuse is going on right now and they want to sweep you under the rug, is oftentimes in the position that they're in, be it an uncle that's, or the guy down the street who's been giving mama milk money, or whatever the case may be. They don't want to disrupt the program, right? Because it's difficult.
I heard this from a lot of women in my, I live in a subdivision, you know, and I've been there 40 years. And a woman came out and told me, said, when I got a divorce, we were all talking about it. These women, I didn't know that well, but people know you in that community.
Mm-hmm.
They said, God, Brenda was lucky. She got out. I don't have a job. I'm depending on my husband. This was in the 80s.
Exactly. And so the people that are subject to abuse feel the same way. They feel trapped. Like they have nowhere to go. You know?
Yeah.
And so we need a vehicle to provide that to the community. We need to give them resources to handle those abuses. And right now we don't.
And even further, I think there needs to be something done. I put this on us as men.
Quickly.
We have to do something in regards to teaching women, young girls, what's appropriate interaction with a man. A young man.
I had to teach a boy and some girls.
And but you know why we're in Durant is like, so my daughter is 22. She's a senior at Wayne State. But he has a young daughter, so he's...
Listen, everybody, we're going to continue this conversation another time because I didn't get to Centoya. But thank you, ladies and gentlemen. This has been great. Thank you so much. See you next week.